Know that Jesus is here as well, that he'll never leave us or forsake us. And I thank you, Lord, that as we look to you, as we worship you in spirit and truth, our desire really is to honor you. Our desire is to see you in all your glory and all your love, your mercy and grace. We ask that you'd speak through the worship. We ask that you would just strengthen Juan and comfort Juan in the pain tonight. And as we just worship you, Lord, let us just fall into your arms all over again in your love. As we look at your word, Lord, just bring clarity to our mind, to our hearts. Glorify yourself tonight in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Days. Ooh. I've forgotten the words that you have spoken. Promises that burn within my heart now burned in. With a doubt you haunt, I follow the path of earthly wisdom.
Good evening and welcome to Calvary Chapel again. Let's open in prayer, Father. We're so thankful that we can be confident that when you began that work in us, that you will finish it until the day of Christ. Lord, as we look at a topic that sometimes is overwhelming, and to some people they're excited about it. Well, Lord, I know it grieves your heart. I know that, Lord, you find no pleasure in the destruction of the wicked. We know that your desire has all come to that saving knowledge and repent of their sins. So, Lord, we cry out for mercy of our own lives, for the times that we've drifted, the distractions that pull us away. But, Lord, we cry mercy that you would reveal yourself in these last days, that you'd open the hearts of many. Lord, that's our desire for our family, for our friends, for people we don't even know. But you know them. So we ask mercy. In Jesus' name, amen. Tonight we move on to the book of Micah. Not Micah, excuse me, Joel. I've been just going through all the minor prophets. See, there's major prophets and there's minor prophets. Major and minor. The only real difference is that major is they're bigger, they're longer. Minor prophets are smaller, but they're just as important. The message is just as powerful. One of the things that we learn about history, and that's kind of what we're looking, history and, again, at the same time, we're looking prophetically, is nothing. Man, you've heard the expression, man continues to repeat history over and over and over again because we like to point the finger at somebody else. See, that's they need to hear it. In reality, we need to hear it. It's interesting as we think of this book again. I've titled it The Great and Dreadful Day of the Lord. It's really an introduction to the book of Joel. Today we set up for it, probably 4 to 6 weeks in it. So today's an introduction. Then we look at our verse-to-verse next week. When we're finished the book, for those that have never been here before, we do a summary. We do three books all at once, or three chapters. And we see how it fits together. Now, the book here of Joel is like Zephaniah. It's a book about the coming judgment. A lot of people mock the coming judgment, but the judgment is coming. And the question is not when is it going to come. The question is, are you ready to meet him now? Are you living for him? Is he preeminent in your life? And that's really what's important. So when people get so focused on these end times, and certainly we're going to look at them, we're going right through the minor prophets, but in a third of the Bible's prophecy. But the application should be is, am I ready to meet him? And I'm never ready to meet him until I'm ready to tell someone else about him and what he's done. That he's merciful and he's gracious. Tell him the character of who he is. The prophet Joel packs a lot into this little book that you're going to see. And I don't know, I could camp. I say 4 to 6 weeks, but you know, sometimes I like to bring in all the history and incorporate it all together. We're going to see judgment in this book. And that's what this introduction is to say, what are we going to see? We're going to see a judgment that came then. But really, there's a judgment still to come. And there's still hope. There's deliverance. For those who call upon the name of the Lord, it might be your friends, your family, people we don't even know. But when this day of the Lord truly begins, it's a wake-up call. I describe the day of the Lord as first, it's about Israel. It's, again, fulfilling the last 7 years, that tribulation. The last 7 weeks of the prophecy we saw when we're in the book of Daniel. is to wake up that nation, to bring through the tribulation the true, again, Jewish people. Those who will turn, who will repent, will acknowledge God for who he is. And then in addition to that is to shake up the heathen. Any heathen here tonight? You were heathen once. Pagan in every way. Every one of us. But God reached down in his mercy and snatched us out of that miry clay, out of those flames that would come. Now, as we see this day of the Lord, we can see again the comparisons when you get to the book of Revelation. In Revelation chapter 14 and verses 15 and 16. And we'll see the comparison again of Joel chapter 3 of verse 13 and 14. And when we get there, we'll look at those more in detail. This time that we're looking at is really, it's going to be a prediction even in this book of the what we call the gospel age. It's not predicting the church, but a time when the outpouring, the Spirit is poured out on the day of Pentecost. And why no one really understood it completely at that time, again, Peter did on the day of Pentecost. And we're going to see the importance of that Holy Spirit and how much you and I need that Holy Spirit in life. So this describes a marvelous future when the Spirit of the Lord will be poured out on all of God's people. Now, Joel, one of the things that you'll see again and again, and I'll mention it often, is he calls for true repentance. The world doesn't know repentance because they don't know sin. So until a person recognizes that they're a sinner separated from God, they'll never understand that repentance is turning from this sinful lifestyle and turning to God, putting off the things of the flesh. But tonight, I'm sure there's still a struggle in your life because we know the Spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. Do we understand that in our lives, all of us? There's this drawing, this temptation, and it is a regular thing in our lives. But you are victorious in Christ. And we'll see that again and again as we go through. Now, when we talk about repentance, I'll pull out one verse here in our text and it'll go on the screen. It's Joel 2:13. Notice what it says, and rend your hearts and not your garments. Now return to the Lord your God, for he's gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and abounding to loving kindness and relenting of evil. See, I like the way it reveals the character of God. Who's the author again? Well, we know it's the Holy Spirit, but it's God himself that is revealing himself. Again, as I mentioned earlier, he finds no pleasure in the destruction of the wicked. He wants all to come to repentance, all to return. And what is he again? Gracious and compassionate. He's slow to anger and abounding in loving kindness and relenting of evil. Well, who is this person, Joel? Joel. I like what his name means. Yahweh is God. Yahweh. They couldn't mention it. We put vowels in there. They would just say the name oftentimes because they wouldn't pronounce it. It was, his name is too holy. There was a what appeared to be a reverence. They had a form of godliness oftentimes, but they denied the power thereof. They showed the reverence and still did what was right in their own eyes. Or like the book of Judges, every man did what was right in his own eyes. And sometimes you see that in the church. We call it hypocrisy. Put on a show. Let people see our best side. I haven't figured out which side is my best side. Sure, thankful God knows our hearts, aren't you? Because we can want to do the right thing, but oftentimes we fall short. He knows the grief in our hearts. He's waiting for us to cry out. He wraps his arms around us in love. Joel's parents had a great desire for him. We don't know much about Joel, but we know that his parents must have been godly parents to give him this name, Yahweh is God. In verse 1 of chapter 1, he's identified as the son of Pethuel. That's about all we know, other than he was a prophet again in the southern kingdom. And he mentions, again, we know a little bit of what he says because we have this book, but he frequently addresses the priesthood. Many have suggested because he talks so much about the priesthood and again, the temple and many places like that, that he must have been a priest. It could have been his father only, but it could have been him. The background, again, in this book doesn't really say a whole lot. The author, it bears his name, that's about it. And unlike the other prophetic books, there's no historical heading. When you're reading, again, many of the prophets, it will give you kings and names of people that you can kind of fit this place and time only because the temple is mentioned. And certain things we can kind of place it in, but you really can't say for sure. So don't find yourself getting in an argument over a date with somebody because it's really worthless. It's the message that's important. In Hosea chapter 1, verse 1, there was an example. Again, the ministry of the prophet Hosea was tied directly to the reign of several kings, as I mentioned. But again, nothing with Joel. And I like that. God knew him. God had given him a message to give. And you too have a message to share. It may not be the same message as, again, Joel, but a message who Jesus Christ is and what he's done. The message can be so simple, a child can believe it. But we have that responsibility. The date, when does this occur? Again, not knowing much about this book, the history, the kings. Again, the prophet has a call to weep. It's between the vestibule and the altar. We'll see that and look at it in detail in chapter 2, verse 17. And this reflects a period during the Second Temple. So we know it's sometime during that Second Temple period of time. Built after the Hebrews returned from Babylon. The book of Joel is usually considered one of the earliest of prophets. When you see them a list, that's by the conservative. The liberals move it way up in time frame. There's only a guess. Somewhere between 830 BC and 750 is the most common suggestions. And people write whole books on trying to figure it out, but let's look at the message as we go through. What we do see is the description of the day of the Lord is adopted in the book of Acts. You remember when we went through the book of Acts and the coming of the Holy Spirit, Peter recognized the fulfillment of Joel, but it's only a partial fulfillment we're going to see as we go through this book. The people would be indwelt with the Spirit of God. And we would become that temple of God, the corporate temple together. Not of stone, but together. So God's presence indwells his people. When we gather together, he is present. He inhabits the praises of his people. He speaks to our hearts. He guides us. He convicts us of our sin. He leads us, the Holy Spirit, in all truth. The Holy Spirit is our comforter that comforts us, gives us the peace that passeth all understanding. The location, Joel ministered, again, as I mentioned, the southern kingdom. Now, if you remember, the northern kingdom was the 10 northern tribes. This is important to understand. And there were two tribes in the south, the southern kingdom. Benjamin was absorbed into Judah, was the larger of the two. We know that because he speaks about the temple of the Lord and then Zion, the hill of Zion, and the references to Judah and Jerusalem. He's not speaking again about, again, the northern kingdom, but it's obvious that he's speaking to those in the south. So what is the purpose of this book? Well, I think one of the main purposes of Joel's concern throughout the whole book, the Day of the Lord. What is the Day of the Lord? Well, it's a time that God deals with his people. Primarily, as I mentioned first, the Jewish people. It's a time of judgment. Because the people have rebelled, they have rejected, they needed to repent. It's a time, again, when Jesus Christ will come back. It will include that. Even, and people will debate this, and you'll have to decide in your own mind, but even the millennial kingdom, I believe myself, quote my opinion. And the reason I say that is because he rules with a rod of iron during the millennial kingdom. Because there's still going to be rebellious man in that period of time that will rebel against him. And yet God finds no pleasure in dealing with that. Now, there's two things in the Bible I want to call your attention to tonight, and one is the day of the Lord and the day of Christ. Now, there'll be people that say, well, they're all the same. Christ is God and Lord. But I want you to think about something. The day of the Lord is always mentioned with judgment. It's always mentioned in the Old Testament. The day of Christ is never mentioned, or the day of the Messiah, or anything else. But you only find that day of Christ three times in the Bible. You'll find it all three times in the book of Philippians. One of the themes about Philippians is really the joy of the Lord. Let me read those three and show you and explain why I say there's a difference. In Philippians 1:6, Paul's writing to the Philippians, if you remember, for I'm confident of this very thing, that he who began a good work in you will perfect it until the day of Christ Jesus. This, most conservative scholars believe, is a reference to the rapture. That he will finish the work in each one of, that is the church, the believers. Day of Christ is addressed to the church uniquely, not to Jewish people necessarily. And then in Philippians 1:10, so that you may approve the things that are excellent in order to be sincere and blameless until the day of Christ. Don't you like the fact that you're kept by the power of God until that day? Anyone think they can be good enough and keep them till that day of salvation? I don't think so. But we're kept as we surrender our life to him. When we fall short, we confess, we repent, we get right, and we get back on that track. And he lifts us up. And I love that. And then in Philippians 2, verse 16, holding fast to the word of life, so that in the day of Christ, I will have reason to glory because I did not run in vain, nor toil in vain. The common meaning for many, again, conservatives on this is talking about, again, when Christ comes, the church should be caught up, and where do we go? We go to that Bema seat, that reward seat. Have a reason. He's taught them. He's poured his life into them, and he wants to present them to Christ. The finished work. There's a part that you and I do in discipling and nurturing those around us. And he felt a responsibility. So in that verse again, holding fast to the word of life, and that's what we need to do, keep our eyes on the author and finisher of faith, but we need to take the word and hide it in our hearts so that in the day of Christ, I will have reason to glory because I did not run in vain. Everything he did was for the glory of God. He was willing to lay down his life for those he was ministering to, first for Christ and for others, that they would see him face to face and hear those words, good and faithful servant. Boy, I long to hear those words, don't you? So this day of the Lord, it's a time of decisive visitation of, I'm going to use the word Yahweh in this case, because sometimes there's the day of Yahweh in the Old Testament. It's when God intervenes again to punish the wicked, the rebellious, and to deliver the faithful remnant. Underline that word or thought whenever you see remnant, because you're going to find from cover to cover, there's only a remnant of true believers. There are many who profess Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. The demons do that, we know. But only a few possess that relationship with Him, who rest and trust in Him, look to Him, make Him preeminent in their lives. Longing for His coming, not the day of the Lord, but longing to see Him come for you. Many years ago, there was a lady in the congregation. She was in home hospice. And before she passed away, her husband went into the room and saw her. She says, no, He hasn't come yet, giving you the indication that she was looking for the Lord to come. And somehow, I believe the Lord's going to come for us all individual. I don't know how that's going to work. And He comes back about an hour or so later. She's looking at the ceiling, has the biggest smile you could ever see, He describes. And He came for her. Not just angels. Just like Stephen, when he was stoned, he looked up and he saw Jesus. Well, the books of Joel and Zephaniah are completely devoted to really proclaiming the day of the Lord. And really, it was meant to be a wake-up call. How many times when you were young did your parents say, don't do this, don't do this? And, you know, if you do this, there's consequences for that. And you went ahead and did it and you had to suffer the consequences. Anyone like that? Yeah. But then don't judge another man's servant. Because if you and I were there at that time, we might have probably done the same thing they did. For you guys, Adam, you would have sinned just like Adam. God's best was Adam and Eve for the ladies. Who are we to think that we're better than the next person? Shame on us. Zephaniah 1:8 says this, then it will come about on that day of the Lord's sacrifice that I will punish the princes, the king's sons, and all who clothe themselves with foreign garments. Day of the Lord, again, I'm mentioning here, is a judgment. He will judge, He will deal with it. There's a lot of evil people in this world. Evil people do evil things, and God will deal with them. It's not my job to go and deal with the evil people. My job is to bring the Great Commission, to equip the saints to do the work of the ministry. Now Ezekiel 7:19 says this, and they will fling their silver into the streets. Their gold will become an abhorrent thing. Their silver and gold will not be able to deliver them in the day of the wrath of the Lord. They cannot satisfy their appetite, nor can they fill their stomachs, for their iniquity has become an occasion of stumbling. There's no way you and I can save us. You can't buy salvation, and some people think they can do that. There was a guy that got saved, a radical testimony, and the money that he had was all drug money, and he kept throwing it at the church like, that's going to make a difference. God wants our hearts. When He has our hearts, then we will do the right things and everything else will follow in line. But people are trusting that they can be good enough. They can buy their way. They can do enough good deeds. But the end, everything they trust in, it's all vanity apart from Christ. Isaiah 2:12 says this, for the Lord, and I'm going to stop there just for a second. I like to remind people, when you see caps, there, capital L-O-R-D, that reminds us that's Jehovah or Yahweh. He's the covenant God. So here the covenant God of hosts will have his day of reckoning against everyone who is proud and lofty, against everyone who is lifted up, that he may be abased. Pride comes before a fall, doesn't it? So this day of the Lord always has to deal with judgment. First dealing with, again, the Jewish people. Those who rejected God's grace. Even though grace is not mentioned in the same way as in the New Testament, but he uses the favor. God had been gracious and merciful to them. So the prophet's purpose here was to warn the nation to repent in light of the approaching judgment. And today there are many that are standing on the corner yelling, "Repent of your sins," as cars go by. And if the people don't know sins, it really is kind of meaningless. Most people come to the Lord on a one-to-one basis, don't they? When they see your light, the greatest testimony, the greatest witness is a life changed. So when you see the prophets, sometimes they live it out, as we saw the book of Hosea. Sometimes they just speak it. Now remember, as we're going through, especially the minor prophets, always warning before wrath. Isn't that true? When you had your kids, if you do that, you're going to get swatted. God also warns us. See, you choose, I choose sin. I choose life or I choose death. It's a choice that we make. So he's warning the people of what is going to come. He wants to stir them up. The faith that is a faithful remnant among the people. There's always a faithful remnant to light a fire underneath them, to encourage them to believe the promises that God has already given them about salvation. And God will deal with the enemies. All these things that we'll see will prefigure again the battle of Armageddon. We talked about that in the book of Revelation when we studied it, and when we come to it, we'll see. And this is a time, again, of regathering of Israel and the kingdom blessings. And Joel presents really a following of order of events as we go through this book. And so as we continue to move through, the pieces of the puzzle will begin to fit together more and more as we continue. Peter, we go to 1 John and Jude and perhaps look at the book of Revelation again. So it's laying this foundation to see all these principles. But are you ready to meet him tonight? Wouldn't this be a good time to come tonight when we're studying the word? Yeah. So we'll see the invasion of Palestine by the Gentile nations under the leadership of the beast. We'll see it in Joel chapter 2 and then Armageddon in the book of Revelation. And we'll see the dissemination of the invading hordes in Joel again, chapter 2, and then Revelation 19. Judah's conversion in the land. Lord's promise of deliverance to those that would just trust in him. The pouring out of the Spirit upon God's people, which is preceding the kingdom age. The second event of Christ with the establishment again of the kingdom. The millennial kingdom, that fulfilling every promise to Abraham at that point. The judgment of nations we'll see again in Joel chapter 3. And then finally at the end of Joel we'll see the realization of the full millennial conditions. The thousand-year reign that Christ reigns. And also, Zechariah, can make a note when we get there, and I'll tell you when we get there, chapter 14. And you see how everything dovetails and fits together, not an afterthought at all. Any more than you're an afterthought. God knew you before the foundation of the world. Let me give you an outline for the book. There's many ways to outline it. People will use different words, different ways. First of all, in the day of the Lord in retrospect. And that's in chapter 1 through verse 20. And it's kind of the past day of the Lord where God brings a judgment. We'll see that, and it's defined. And then we'll see the past day of the Lord again all the way through chapter 1. And then we'll see the day of the Lord in prospect. And that begins in chapter 2, and it goes right through the end of the book. The imminent day of the Lord could be any moment to them. And finally, that ultimate day of the Lord, when that judgment finally comes. Many people mock that there's a time of judgment coming. Many people know that something's on the horizon. It can't continue the way it is, but they don't know what to do. That's where we become that witness, that light. Israel was set aside, one of the reasons for their rebellion, and that they weren't a light to the Gentiles, and we too can be set aside. Aside, if we're not that light that God's called us to be. The key theme then of this book is really the day of the Lord. Retrospect, prospect, looking the future. Just like the feast of the Lord, they looked back to what God had done and they looked forward prophetically. You find the pattern so often right through the scripture. And then we'll see that terrible locust plague. Was it literal? Many people argue over it. They see glimpses of it in the book of Revelation, and how can they bring the balance? And we'll look at how do the people at that time understand that passage? Because we really need, if it's written to them, to understand, how did they understand it before we can apply it to ourselves? We tend to look through our eyes through the newspaper, sensationalism, newspaper interpretation, as it's been called. And we'll see how God deals with each one of these things. Tonight, you'll see it's going to be just a short message because it's just a setup, but I want to give you some key verses here just for a moment. Joel chapter 2, verse 11 and 12, follow with me. The Lord utters his voice before his army. Surely his camp is very great. For strong is he who carries out his word. The day of the Lord indeed is great and very awesome. And who can endure it? And even now, declares the Lord, return to me with all of your heart and with fasting and weeping and mourning. Prophesied it's coming, but Who can endure it? And there's that call to repent. Do you hear the heart of God? There are many things that God's going to reveal in your life as you continue to walk with the Lord, like peeling an onion away, and he gives you one thing at a time. And I love that because he gives you just what you can bear at that time, showing you something about your heart that you didn't know, that you can confess and repent. And that's his heart. Now, it says, return to me with all your heart and with fasting and weeping and mourning. And you need to get serious. It's not just a matter of, Lord, I repent. And I do it again and again and again and again and again. That's not repenting. It's turning from your sin and turning to God. And he will lift you, and he will carry you, and he will empower you. See, that's where your power is, when you turn to him. And there should be really a broken and contrite heart, a grieving, a mourning over the choices, over our sin. God, if there's going to be a change in my heart, you've got to do it. Create in me a clean heart, O God, that I might not sin against you. It's called being serious about our sins. And we'll see that as we go through the book. And then it's also in Joel chapter 2. See, Joel chapter 2 is really the key chapter in this book. In Joel 2, 28 and 29, notice what it says. It will come about after this that I will pour out my spirit upon all mankind. Notice all mankind. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your old men will dream dreams. Your young men will see visions. And even on the male and female servants, I will pour out my spirit in those days. And we're going to talk about the spirit, how important the spirit of God is in our life. And is this for today? Is it for tomorrow? How does this work in our life? We know on the day of Pentecost, the spirit was given. And some people deny the spirit even today after everything that's happened. And some are so obsessed with the spirit that they don't even know who Jesus Christ is, seeking the gifts instead of the giver himself. And the Spirit is to lead us in all truth. He's our comforter. Well, there's a focus on being God's people. Some people are ashamed to be called a Christian. There was a time it was okay to be a Christian. Oh, you're a Christian, that's fine. You know, that's good for weak people. They just believe what they hear. But what's important to understand, God, if God is for you, who could ever be against you? God's given us so many promises in Romans 8:28, all things work for the good for those who love the Lord, called according to his purpose. Think of the Old Testament, Joseph, and he says, speaking to his brothers, what you meant for evil, God used for good. Do you see how God turns things around? When something's going wrong in your life, how do you know it's bad? God uses those things, and we're going to see in time of crisis, what do we do? How do we deal with it? So when God's people were threatened, surrounded by their enemies, you ever feel like that? I have. Things crushing from every direction. God promised to bring salvation to his people, to empower them with the Holy Spirit. That peace that passeth all understanding. It's in a world when things don't make sense and everything's caving in. And you have a smile and they say, wipe that stupid smile off your face because you have this peace. The world can't understand it. God's in control. Well, God has poured his Holy Spirit upon every believer, allowing us to be adopted, placed into his family, empowering us, again, to live for him. And for the nation Israel, they were the only holy nation. This nation, United States, I'm glad to be here, but it's never been a holy nation, never will be a holy nation. There's only one holy nation. It's the nation of Israel, the only one that God ever speaks about that was his nation. And we're grafted into the promises of that nation. But we are a holy priesthood. Holy, being set apart for him. Kept for him, pure. Boldly go to that throne of grace. 1 Peter 2:9, notice what it says. For you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation. And this is really, for Jewish people, this is really, and they want to argue and fight over it because this is talking about Israel. However it is, it works out. I take the pan theory. Some of you tonight don't know the pan theory, I don't think. Pan theory is those things, well, let's not argue about. It's not black and white in the scripture. We'll see how it pans out in the end. God's in control. We don't need to understand everything. What we need to understand is who God is. And what has he said and what is he going to do for sure. But we are a people for God's own nation. We're grafted in so that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who has called you. And notice he's called you out of darkness into a marvelous light. Well, we see it again, a picture of Christ. You could say the picture of Jesus in the book. And I always like to find, again, Jesus or Christ in every book. He's there. Prophet Joel anticipated that day of the Lord as a great and dreadful day, is how he puts it. It was a day of salvation, but it was a day of judgment. Jesus came into the world to save it. John 3:16, we all know that. And one day he will judge the world in righteousness. Acts 10:42, let me read that. And he ordered us to preach to the people and solemnly testify, this is to the one who has been appointed by God to judge the living and the dead. And also in Acts 17:31, we'll talk about these things and connect them more when we get into the book. Jesus is that judge, and he will judge righteously. I was recently talking to a brother, and he got a ticket over a seatbelt. And I thought about my ticket and my seatbelt, and I'm getting ready to go on the street, but I'm not on there. I hadn't put my seatbelt on, but I put it on before I went on the street, and I got a ticket. $75 it was then. A lot of money. But what was I going to do, argue with him? When God judges, he knows righteously he judges. You'll never be misaccused, abused by him. And for the believer, we will be at the judgment seat of Christ. That is the reward seat. He's entrusted you with his gifts, his ability, his word. What do you do with it? He's going to reward you for it. All of your sins were judged upon the cross. When you sin now, you break the fellowship with him, but you don't lose salvation. But you've broken fellowship. Just as if you said something hurtful to somebody else, you've broken the fellowship until you confess and you apologize. What can I do to make it right? Joel portrays Christ as the one who will judge the nations in the valley of Jehoshaphat. And God will judge in the end. In the resurrection, the Lord has commissioned the apostles to proclaim him as the judge of the living and the dead. In John chapter 5, verse 22, notice what it says, and not even the Father judges anyone, but he has given all judgment to his Son. This means, of course, that the Son of Man, he will judge the Jews and the Gentiles alike. Acts 17:31. Because he has fixed a day in which he will judge the world in righteousness through the man whom he has appointed, having furnished proof to all men by raising him from the dead. He's conquered death. And because he's conquered death, we have life. We have life eternal. And we're supposed to have life abundant if we take his word, hide it in our hearts. If we follow him with all of our hearts. If we seek first the kingdom of God, his righteousness, and know that God's going to take care of all things. The prophet simply visualized the day to come. I've heard many people visualize the day to come, and I kind of cringe because many of those I heard don't even line up with what the Bible is saying. We have to remember the Bible's the plumb line. God's revealed what he wants us to know about the future. I know when I close my eyes in this world where I'm going. Do you know where you're going? That's the heart of a Savior. Jesus is going to fulfill the prophecy in two parts. In his first coming, about 2,000 years ago, and when he returns, in power and glory and victory. I think you'll find this book, little book, powerful book, small, but his message is powerful. It It's practical. And it's for today. So let us close in prayer. Father, thank you for tonight. Just this introduction to this book, the things that you're going to show us, the things that you're going to explain. Lord, I pray as we see the things that are going to occur here around the day of the Lord, Lord, that you'd move us from to evangelism, to reaching out and telling people about Christ, praying for the lost, being available that you might use us for your glory. So Lord, we thank you, not just for this book of Joel, but for your word that is timeless, practical, applicable for us today. So Lord, we bless your name. We look with excitement, anticipation, what you're going to do in our hearts as we continue to walk through your word day by day. In Jesus' name, amen.